Now the last speaker who will speak in English, not as it appeared in the presentation, Dr. Marco Silber, is a senior lecturer at the chair and the chair of the Department for Jewish History at the University of Haifa. He has written extensively on Jewish diaspora nationalism in Poland, Lithuania, and Russia in the early 20th century. Now he is writing a book on the transference of motives between Polish nationalism and Zionism. His major publication includes different nationality, equal citizenship, the effort to achieve autonomy from Polish Jewry during the First World War. What's the name in Hebrew? It's in Hebrew. It's published in 2014. And his paper now is going to be a very interesting topic, reassessing the acculturation paradigm, Yiddish and Polish popular culture in interwar Poland.
Thank you the organizers, and thank you especially Moshe and Gershon for sharing with me, along with the last decade, ideas, comments, and time. And especially for conceptualizing for all of us central aspects, topics, issues, and questions in the field of Polish-Jewish and Polish-Jewish history. Among these topics, both Gershon and Moshe contributed extensively to conceptualize the particular characteristics and outcomes the acculturation process had in Poland. The concept of acculturation reflects the notion that ethnic groups have distinct cultures, and members of one ethnic group adopt the culture of another. Scholars attribute two primary features to the acculturation process: unidirectionality and linearity. In the context of Jews in Poland, the Polish majority is traditionally perceived as having exerted a unilateral influence upon the smaller Jewish collective, which adopted the Polish language, habitus, and cultural practices. Acculturated Jews are thus perceived and said to have perceived themselves as less Jewish than the contemporary image of Jewishness, unilaterally adapting themselves to a given Polish cultural majority, their cultural distinctiveness began to diminish. With respect to linearity, cultural elements of the Polish majority group are represented as retaining their semantic content during their adoption by the minority Jewish community, which preserved Polish and its semantic connotations, maintaining similar meaning and linguistic registers and sociocultural significance. The following very preliminary reflections are intended to explore features to the acculturation process in light of the complex nature and structure of interactions and interdependencies in a very specific place, time, field, case, and particular economic conditions. The place and time are interwar Poland, where a cultural discourse being dictated from above sought to strengthen ethnification and a nationalizing policy towards minority groups. At the same time, the dynamics, dialectics, and tension this policy created were challenged by counter responses offering alternative routes. One of these arose in the field of new mass urban culture, and especially in the case of literary cabaret in economic conditions characterized by the commodification of culture. I will follow Gershon's path by checking the tricky path of acculturation the acculturation took in interwar Poland, in an article cited by Kamil today, and simultaneously I will check it in a field that Moshe pointed out as having peculiar characteristics in an article cited by David Engel yesterday, mass culture. Some of those who engaged in Polish literary cabaret manifested a strong Jewish identity, much of their praxis also being dominated by their Jewishness.
The cases of the popular actors Josef Ullstein or Dora Kalinovna exemplifies the case of the importance of Jewishness and the Yiddish language for these artists performing in Polish. Many of these figures were considered assimilated. The cabaret performers and writers Kazimierz Kurkowski, Konrad Tom, or Ludwig Lawinski, for example. In case of others, their Jewish consciousness only formed one aspect of their professional career, as in the case of the singer, actor, and pianist Adam Aston, who performed in Polish, Yiddish, and Hebrew, and the Kleinkunst cabaret artist Ola Lilith, who performed in Yiddish and Polish. For many others, a central Jewish characteristic lay in the vivid way in which their social environment reminded them of it, as in the case of Julian Tuvi. All these figures frequently performed with non-Jews. It is perhaps less known that at the same time, they themselves were sometimes from unclear ethno-national backgrounds. Such was the case of the handsome man from film and theater, the Swiss Calvinist Eugenius Bodo, or the well-known conferencier, the Czech-Hungarian Friedrich Jarosz. Others were perceived to be Jews, such as the well-known poet and writer Antoni Słonimski, the Christian-born grandson of Kaiserius Słonimski. Such a heterogeneous group of writers, musicians, and performers intersected the Jewish and Polish ethnocultural spheres, serving as a Germanian frontier, the site of intercultural encounters. Based on their former experience, they offered a metropolitan window onto the world. They polonized the chanson of Fin de siècle Paris, adopted the social satire of the Munich cabaret, replaced the elitism of the pre-war Krakow Zielone Balonik with a rich popular program, and adopted sets and structures of the Russian exile in Berlin, Sinia Yaptitsa, the Bluebird cabaret. They also reshaped the uncouth Jewish characters of the Viennese cabaret, transforming them into a new genre that came to be known as schmontzes, being, after the songs, the most popular part of the show. Knut Grimstad, Beth Olmgren, and Dorota Fox analyzed the reason of its popularity among Jews and non-Jews. Schmontzes, they claim, became the language in which the illogic characteristics of everyday new life of interwar Polish urban reality could be represented. Literary cabaret challenged the hegemonic notions of Polishness and the discourse surrounding its evolvement in an oppressive, polonocentric age that increasingly assumed an essentialist character. It staged its alternative with a repertoire that represented Polish society as a multi-ethnic entity. It did that with a multi-ethnic cast, including many polonizing Jews and Judaizing Poles and others across a wide range of fluid identities. Hereby, it related to Polishness as a contested topic in a permanent state of construction and conflict. They transcended the small stage by selling recording sketches and music records in the thousands. As a commodified cultural event, however, its transformation into a political possibility largely remained on the theoretical level. Although the language in which it was performed was Polish, showing the world through these lenses, the performance itself undermined this prism, reflecting the dialogic reflexivity of its creators and actors. Characterized by bad pronunciation, it explicitly modulated Polish in foreign accents, Hungarian, German, Russian, and foreign words and expressions, French, Yiddish. It placed particular emphasis upon the Jewish way of speaking Polish, highlighting either its high register or the Jewish accent or ethnolect. It also played with the Polish language, a game at which Tuwim excelled, creating a new sociolinguistic register. Rather than merely artistic or commercial decision, this constituted a subversive political move, offering an alternative to the puristic vision of language and society. Contemporary critics draw attention to the way in which cabaret created a particular language with its own syntax, intentionally stylistic errors, word formations, and lexical neologism, every term representing a concept, as the literary critic, playwriter, and translator Tadeusz Boyd-Zielenski wrote in 1924. Reviewers repeatedly noted its popularity and infectious character, citing offstage examples. Not surprisingly, the Polish Academy of Literature, the establishment gatekeeper of the purity and beauty of the Polish language, launched an official campaign against the language of the Schmonces in September 1936 that led to their censorship in Warsaw. Many contemporaries portray this new popular culture as an alien Sajidzenie, Judaization of Polish culture. This particular group of people, Jews and non-Jews, characterized by a wide range of mother tongues and identities, thus created something unprecedented in the Polish cultural arena. Adopting models from other parts of Europe, they adapted them to the newly emergent urban reality of interwar Poland. Staging a variety of accents, experimenting with a new language, they challenged the essentialist concept of language and nationality. Instead of acculturating themselves to a given Polish culture, these Jews constituted, together with people from other denominations and ethno-cultural backgrounds, new, distinctive, and unique mixture of countercultural essence. In this regard, the interwar literary cabaret in Poland challenges the acculturation paradigm as a mechanical process. This particular case suggests that rather than accommodating themselves to Polish culture, Jews, whether or not they identified as such, were co-constitutive of a new cultural entity. Moreover, without the Jews, whether Kua Jews or not, there would have been no such Polish popular culture. To the extent that they jointly produce it with their fellow non-Jews artists, they cannot be said to have acculturated themselves to it. Polish literary cabaret also reshaped popular Yiddish culture. The sophisticated Yiddish Kleinkunst theater was partially modeled on the Polish literary, on the Polish language literary cabaret. The first Yiddish Kleinkunst theater, Azazel, was founded in Warsaw in 1926. Reviewing its premiere, Menachem Kipnis, the Yiddish Daily Hind Theater and Music Reviewer, wrote, "Yes, indeed, a Yiddish qui pro quo, a Yiddish perske oko, could be created in Warsaw." His insight was absolutely, even literally, correct. The performs themselves coming straight from the Polish literary cabaret cast. The conferencier was Władysław Godik, an experienced artist of the cabaret genre in the Polish state. The principal star, his life, Ola Lili, a qui pro quo singer. Through their skills, they brought their experience in the Polish language literary cabaret to the Yiddish stage. Godik and Lili performed for many years with the stars of qui pro quo in Polish and on the Yiddish stage simultaneously, such duality coming naturally to them. The transfer was neither one-directional nor limited to a sole occasion. Many other Polish language cabaret actors and actresses played together with Yiddish actors for the Yiddish-speaking public, going back and forth from the Yiddish and the Polish stage. Moishe Broderson, one of the founders of Azazel, established in 1927 the very popular Kleinkunst Ararat in Lodz, which modeling it even more after the Polish language cabaret. He introduced in Ararat the sarcastic cabaret ode a la qui pro quo, the Ararat Shimi, it was called. It's a kind of leitmotiv of the theater, together with political sketches similar to those on the qui pro quo or Morskie Oko stage. Also challenging normative language along the lines of qui pro quo by employing on the Yiddish stage the Lodz Yiddish dialect. Broderson was also responsible for discovering Shimon Gigan and Israel Schumacher, who went on from Ararat to become the most celebrated Jewish comedy team in Poland, where their performances reflected various models from the contemporary silver screen, Laurent Hardy, and Charlie Chaplin, they also transferred the acts of Konrad Tom and Ludwig Lawinski on their Max and Moritz Schmonzes from the Polish language cabaret to the Yiddish stage. This Yiddish cabaret, as a paradox of the Polish one, makes it difficult to maintain the acculturation paradigm that suggests that in the process of acculturation, the acculturated Jew became less Jewish, and also do not fit the linear adoption of semantic content, connotations, meaning, and linguistic registers, since the process shows translation of semantic content connotations, meaning and linguistic register, into the realm of Yiddish popular culture. Many Jews engaged in popular music introduced jazz and tango into popular Polish music during the interwar period. This sphere was heavily represented by Jews. Artur Gol, Jerzy Peterburski, Henryk Warz, and Zygmunt Białostocki were responsible for the vast majority of the pre-war tango, jazz, and swing hits. Their songs becoming the epitome of Polish popular music during the interwar period. Hereby, musical rhythms such as tango, as we can hear, found their way into Polish popular musical culture with a very particular touch, as you can hear. The more local tangos were composed, the farther away the rhythmic basis moved from its Argentinian origins, achieving a unique character. And believe me, they are being a recognizable as tango for Argentinians. A prime example was Zygmunt Białostocki, Rebecca, you can hear, which became his most beloved and frequently recorded song. First sang by actress and singer Dora Kalinovna in the Morskie Oko Cabaret in 1932 in Warsaw. Rebecca became a nationwide hit overnight. The stage setting in Morskie Oko was the marketplace in Kazimierz Dolny, Kazimierz nad Wisłą, the Polish state emblematic of Polish Jewish coexistence. Echoing the tale of Esterke, Rebecca tells the story of a Jewish shopkeeper girl who falls passionately in love at first sight with a chivalrous non-Jew. She begins to dream about a better life with him. When she sees him again, however, he is with a Christian girl. Rather than regarding this type of song as a kind of mayufes or Jewish mockery, the Yiddish press viewed it as a sensitive rendering of a moving situation. Menachem Kipnis note that in Rebecca Białostocki gives a gift to Polish society by providing us with the rich, unknown, exotic Yiddish songs and popular tunes. He also gave it to us, the Jews. Both Jews and non-Jews identified this tango and tango in general as Jewish music. Anti-Semites in particular denouncing it and calling in the cabaret for death to the Jewish tango. We do not want any more Rebecca. This was not only a right-wing battle cry against the sajidzenie of Polish culture, but also resistance to what they perceived to be the new Jewish Polish culture. Like many other Polish songs during the interwar period, it was translated into Yiddish. Different Yiddish versions were recorded in which Rebecca inevitably became Rivkele. In one version, Rivkele runs off with her beloved, breaking her parents' hearts. In the other, they continue to love one another, but merely platonically. Also, Mordechai Gebirti, the preeminent Yiddish folk artist and troubadour, composed in 1936, a peculiar version of Rebecca. In his Blumke, Mein Jidufke, a Jewish girl rejects a Polish shepherd's advances and courtship with the words, Such die Reus im Dorf an Golke, ich bin a Jidufke. While in Rebecca, the Polish noble Goy rejects the poor Jewess, in Gebirtig's Yiddish, the gentle Jewess turns away the poor Goy. As other of his songs and poems, was adopted and incorporated as an original, authentic Yiddish popular song inspired by Jewish folklore. As in other cases, here we see cultural elements of one group, how cultural elements of one group changed their semantic content as they were adopted by another. This mutual and dynamic process represented and interpreted the original culture, imbuing it with new meaning in its new context. Significantly, these musical rhythms did not exist in pre-World War I Poland. The group of musicians who composed this popular music, also frequently being identified as Jewish, in fact created songs that became essential assets of Polish popular culture. This phenomenon makes it difficult to adduce Polish acculturation in this case. Rather than the linear mechanics of acculturation, it was in fact a form of transference from Polish to Yiddish and vice versa. The linearity of the acculturation paradigm, in which cultural elements of one group retain their semantic content in the process of adoption by another, are therefore absent here. The transfer of cultural motifs through music and lyrics from one collective to another altering the original meaning. The new translated form transformed them linguistically, imparting new meaning and challenging older patterns. Conclusion. A group of artists, Jews and non-Jews on the social cultural frontier transferred elements from other cultures into an ostensibly clear-cut Polish or Jewish culture, co-determining cultural meaning and shaping the culture to which they belong in both Polish and Yiddish. In creating, disseminating, and participating in popular mass culture in Poland, Jews co-constituted with their fellow non-Jews original cultural process that did not exist neither in the Polish cultural sphere nor in the Yiddish one before that. The examples presented here evince that the cultural changes did not only take place within the smaller group, the Jewish minority. When new values and practices were adopted, the cultural features of both collectives were affected by their mutual encounter and contact with other parts of society. This is incommensurate with the passive, unilateral, linear process of acculturation paradigm. There was no unidirectional influence on the part of so-called non-Jews upon Jews, since the non-Jewish cultural sphere also being altered by the Jewish one. The two groups interrelated in numerous ways, their respective cultural context changing in consequence. Rather than unilateral, this was a mutual and dynamic process. By the outbreak of World War II, many elements of Polish and Yiddish popular culture had become a singular Polish-Jewish blend that frequently also resisted its symbiotic nature. When the peculiar process of cultural transference helped integrate two publics, it also fueled that Blumian anxiety of culture. This anxiety also ostensibly recreated two separate cultural spheres, united as well by the denial of the transfer.